When people start putting their hands in the state cookie jar, it's often impossible to catch them.
Do I look like somebody that's been in prison? And don't answer that. Well, I'm going to talk with you today about my experiences in financial planning, my experiences in world politics, my experiences as a farm boy that went to college, became a very successful financial planner, became a certified financial planner, registered principal, an OSJ with offices all over the country, to someone that got involved in a financial fraud scheme with the state of Oklahoma. Instead of facing prosecution, I chose to leave the country, lived as an international fugitive for 4 years, self-surrendered, served 4 more years in a foreign jail and federal prisons. Now, before I get started, I want to ask you a couple questions. One is, first of all, I already asked, does anybody want to go down the path I did? Obviously not. Number two, are there any unethical people in here? Anybody that considers himself unethical? Couple on the line? I didn't think there would be. Third question. Do you ever wonder why smart people can do such dumb things? Do you ever wonder why people, you pick up the newspaper every day and people that seemingly have had this illustrious career throw it all away for something that seems relatively minor? Enron, the trial's going on right now. Who in here thinks that Kenneth Lay's going to get off? You know what? When I speak in Texas and ask that question, 3/4 of the audience raises their hand and says he'll get off. When I'm back east, 90% raise their hand and say he's going to get off. When I come to Orange County, nobody thinks he's going to get off. I love that. I live in San Diego. I can appreciate that. How about Dennis Kozlowski? Remember him? He decides to use Tyco as his own personal piggy bank to the tune of $600 million. How on earth does someone that's the CEO of a huge company like that decide that it's okay for him to hit the mark, to go ahead and stick his hand in the cookie jar? It's interesting to me as I travel across the country and speak to see the regional differences. Now, does that mean that all of us have little ethical pockets and we all perceive ethics in a different manner at each state? Or is there a general realization that everybody's going to get away with a little something every once in a while? And when we face that ethical dilemma, maybe it's going to be me this time. Maybe I'm going to be able to pull it off. Now, I know a lot of you in this industry, because I was in it for so long and love it so much, a lot of you face ethical dilemmas on a daily basis. There's a lot of pressure on you from regulation. There's a lot of pressure on you from clients to do things that may be not quite right and not quite wrong. And I know you've all made the right decisions because that's why you're in here. You're the cream of the crop. But there's a lot of brokers out there that sometimes don't make that right decision. I'm here today not to teach you ethics. Everybody has their own perception of ethics in here. But I am here today to share with you some of the ethical dilemmas that I faced and how I mishandled some and how I handled others very well. Because when I went to prison, you know the first thing that I found out that shocked me, the very first thing, I thought when I go into prison, everybody's going to look like those old ratty, scroungy guys with the greasy hair and the tattoos all over them on that show, Cops, that they're yanking out of their house at 6 o'clock in the morning. But I quickly found out everybody looked just like everybody in this room. They all looked pretty normal. That was scary. The second thing I found out was that 3 out of 4 men released from prison go back in within 3 years. 3 out of 4 are rotating back in within 3 years. I thought, you know, I know exactly what I did that got me in here, and I'm going to go into that in detail. I'm clear as a bell on that, but I'm not clear on why the heck I did it. I didn't have to do it. I didn't need the money. I didn't need the prestige. I didn't need the perceived power. If I don't get clear on that, I'm in big trouble. I thought, well, here's an opportunity because I'm going to be spending a whole lot of time in a very small space with a whole lot of guys with one thing in common. We all broke the law. We all did something unethical, immoral, illegal. I started to talk to them. I thought, if I don't get clear on this, I'm going to be one of those 3 out of 4 coming back. So a funny thing happened over the course of the next several years. As I talked to these guys, I kept hearing the same recurring patterns. Same stuff. And I broke it down to 8 critical thinking errors that underpin all white-collar crime, all heinous crime, all unethical behavior. 8. These eight critical thinking errors are present in all crime, all unethical behavior. And as I unwind them, people's faces are going to flash in your mind. Sometimes it might be your face. Don't be afraid. Sometimes it'll be people that you're related to. Or I guarantee you, you're going to have some clients coming up. But as I go through this, just keep in mind that these eight critical thinking errors, anytime, any part of the day, we're all fallible human beings. We're all subject to them. We're all subject to the temptation or just the glide right into them. Now, the first critical thinking error that's at play along the way here, this one I call the queen mother of all critical thinking errors. This one is present in all unethical behavior. And anybody with teenagers is going to totally identify with this word. It's called entitlement. What does entitlement mean? Essentially, it's a feeling that the world owes us something, somebody owes us something, or we deserve something. Now, why do we deserve something? Pretty much because we're us. And that's good enough for us. We're all that. Doesn't mean we've earned it. It just means we deserve it. This must be the evolution of my career, the next step in the corporate ladder of success. But I always tell the college kids, as you climb your corporate ladder of success, make sure that ladder leans against the right building. Mine leaned against a dollar bill, always went with the flow, let circumstances dictate where I was going. Now, the second critical thinking error is at play here. It's called super optimism. Essentially, super optimism is a feeling that we can get away with anything we want, we can do whatever we want, we're above the law, we're smarter than everybody else. And there's no reason to think that there's anything in our way that we can't overcome. Supreme optimism. I had it in spades. You can combine entitlement and super optimism into one word called arrogance. You know anybody that's arrogant? Maybe a little bit of entitlement, super optimism. Has anyone here ever been on the floor of the New York Stock Exchange? Have you ever seen it on TV, all the insanity that goes on, the pushing, shoving, talking on the phone, papers flying everywhere, 2,500 to 3,000 people just running around in a room about this big? It's nuts. Well, I stood in the back corner just like this. For about a minute, I was totally intimidated, trying not to get run over. And a funny thing happened, because as I looked around, I started to realize, you know what? These are my people. This is my tribe. This is the group that I want to align with. All they do is talk about making money. I'm all about making the money, and that's all they do. 24/7, it's money, money, money. They eat too much, they drink too much, they smoke too much, they die at 35, I'll get out at 33. I had it all figured out in my head.